Welcome back to Kudlow and Company. I'm Bill Griffith in for Larry tonight. Speaking of Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson, he talked about the need to change Sarbanes-Oxley during that speech on Monday. Listen.
Excessive regulation slows innovation, imposes needless costs on investors, stifles competitiveness and job creation. We need to implement the law in ways that better balance the benefits of the legislation with a very significant cost it imposes, especially on small businesses. We can't legislate or rulemake our way to ethical behavior, whether it be in the business world or any other endeavor.
So it sounds like Sarbox is going to get some tweaking in the Democratic Congress coming up. Our next guest helped mastermind with his cousin, Eddie Antar, one of the largest security frauds of its time. For those of you of a certain age who don't remember Crazy Eddie, here's a reminder.
Shop around, get the lowest sale prices you can find, then go to Crazy Eddie and he'll beat them. It's Crazy Eddie Day. Say big, big, big bucks during Crazy Eddie's Crazy Eddie Day sale. Crazy Eddie, his prices are insane.
Joining us is Sammy Antar, the former chief financial officer of the now defunct Crazy Eddie Inc., and our panel members join us as well. Mr. Antar, thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you, sir.
How difficult is it to watch those old commercials?
It brings back a lot of memories, mostly bad memories.
You're pretty penitent, aren't you, about those days?
Yes, but reality is penitence doesn't count. It's what you do. It's not what you say.
And what are you doing now?
I volunteer teaching colleges, universities, the government about white-collar crime. I do it all for free. I don't take even cost reimbursements.
And a big soapbox you're on right now is that you feel that Sarbanes-Oxley is not enforced enough. You think it needs more teeth. Why?
Yes, because the accounting profession, let's start with that. Most accounting students, before they graduate college, never take a single specific course in fraud, never take a single specific course in securities law, never take a single specific course in internal controls. So no wonder we have the check-the-boxes, fill-in-the-blanks routine from audits. That doesn't work. We want them to be more judgmental. They're not trained to be more judgmental. They're too process-oriented. The criminal is judgment-oriented and always has the initiative. It's like going to bat with two strikes against you already.
What do you say? Wait a minute. What do you say to those companies now that are having to comply with Sarbanes-Oxley, especially these small companies that Secretary Paulson talked about? It's too onerous. The restrictions placed by Sarbanes-Oxley actually restrict their growth rate, and it's too expensive to implement. What do you say?
It's like insurance. It's a necessary evil, but everybody has to pay for it.
All right, John Relidge, what do you say?
I say that Sarbanes-Oxley sucks. It makes it illegal to run a small business in America. The baggage on running a small mutual fund today is about $1 million a year worth of lawyer costs. It is keeping growth down, and I think Sarbanes-Oxley is not the problem. It does not teach those accounting students. What we need is to enforce the laws we already had before this happened.
Gary?
The British have a enforcement system based on principles as opposed to specific laws. And that makes a lot more sense, because when you put in specific laws, then all that happens is the crooks figure out how they can get around those laws in a gray area. That's what's happened. And putting in more regulations and tighter regulations and more hoops to jump over is ridiculous. It just, as John says, it just costs money, and it doesn't stop the crooks, because they are very creative. They'll figure out a way around that.
Ben Stein, I'm curious your thoughts on Sarbanes-Oxley.
Well, I think it's a wonderful thing. I'm stunned to hear all of this criticism of it. Mankind is by nature a sinful and thieving being. This seems to be especially true in the corporate suites and high echelons of finance. Sarbanes-Oxley is a small cost compared to the incredible value of being straight and honest with your trustors, the people who put up their money and whom you work for. There is no more important good than being honest with the trustor stockholders of America. I don't give much of a damn whether or not people list their stocks on London or somewhere else other than New York. I want the people who are listed in America to give a straight, honest count to their stockholders. They're not doing it. I do not understand what Mr. Paulson means when he says that morality and ethics cannot be legislated. We never said it could. We just want to put people in jail who break the law and therefore discourage them from robbing from their own stockholders. And it seems to me we're not doing enough of it. The cost of doing it is trivial compared with the cost in morality and ethics of destroying the capitalist system by destroying the trust between stockholders and their managers.
John Relidge, we just looked at a wall of shame of faces that are a direct cause of Sarbanes-Oxley. When you go back to the Enron scandal, you go back to the ImClone scandal, We got Crazy Eddie up there. He was years before that. But if there had been five Crazy Eddies at that time, you probably would have had a Sarbanes-Oxley at that time, wouldn't you?
Yes, what, and you, I mean, wouldn't have stopped any one of those frauds that were on that wall of shame.
How would you have solved the crisis of confidence that this country suffered from as a result of all of those corporate scandals?
The problem is exactly what you said, Bill. You said that those frauds caused Sarbanes-Oxley. Washington is a town about marketing, not about policy. This happened after the horse was out of the barn. The laws are in place to not create fraud before. They could have been enforced before. Sarbanes-Oxley has nothing to do with this.
I disagree, sir.
Go ahead.
I disagree. First of all, Sarbanes-Oxley is not effective enough because of the accounting profession that doesn't have the requisite level of competence to enforce it. Second of all, we still have laws that that do not create effective oversight, like audit committees. We have audit committee members that have that are just there with great resumes, wonderful people, but they're not fit to serve on audit committees.
You feel that there is a deficiency at the education level in the accounting business. Talk about that.
I'm a CPA by training myself.
What's missing in the education for CPAs?
Fraud. Only 20% of accounting students are ever exposed to fraud courses. Okay, only 318 colleges and universities offer fraud courses. You want to enforce Sarbanes-Oxley? These kids, they learn about internal controls in a couple of afternoons in an auditing course. No wonder why you have a process-oriented situation here. They don't know anything about criminology. What are the incentives to commit crime? They're our first line of defense, and they're no match for criminals like I used to be.
John? Gary?
Yeah, well, you've got to separate what's going on here. I'm on corporate audit committees, and audit committees do have responsibilities for what's going on internal. But when you're talking about outside auditors, those people are not... Their assignment isn't to come in there and uncover fraud. Yes, they have to be on the lookout for it, but they're primarily there to make sure that the books work and to assist the internal auditors. But to say that they ought to be, in effect, quasi-government watchdogs coming in and automatically looking for fraud, that's a whole different assignment.
Yes, but it's material fraud.
The people couldn't do that. But you've got to have some confidence that management itself is honest. And if they aren't, hey, they got to be tossed out. They got to go to jail.
Go ahead, Sammy.
Yes, but it's material fraud that we're talking about. And white-collar crime is just as brutal as violent crime because you all pay for it. Your collective market capitalizations of all your companies go down as a result of the frauds that have been committed. That's why we had the market meltdowns from all the previous corporate frauds.
But,
so it's not a contained crime, white-collar crime.
But Ben Stein,
you all pay for it.
Ben Stein, the sense I get is that those who are critical of Sarbanes-Oxley feel not only the onerousness and the cost and everything, it's just another layer of regulation that's unnecessary right now.
But it isn't unnecessary. We have so much fraud. We have so much misconduct. It's proved to be not unnecessary. I mean, you didn't even start with the granddaddy of all the frauds in the last 20 years, the Drexel Milken fraud, which tied in with the SNL fraud and cost the taxpayers of this country over $100 billion. The level of fraud in this country is extremely serious. There needs to be a lot of regulation to stop it. I mean, we have laws because man is a sinful being that needs policing. It's that simple.
Yeah, but none of that says Sarbanes-Oxley is going to solve the problem. Sarbanes-Oxley does not solve the problem of behavior.
I am the former criminal over here, and I'm telling you that will help solve the problem. You guys are all legitimate people. You never committed crimes.
Wait a minute, Sammy. What about the thing Gary Schilling said? You know, you set up a new roadblock, and the crook will find a new way to get around it.
Well, you know, that's a defeatist attitude.
But at least there's a roadblock
for a while. That's really a defeatist attitude, sir.
Yeah, and also, Sammy, if you look at all the big frauds on Wall Street or elsewhere, they didn't get tripped up by the regulators. The regulators are Johnny-come-lately. Look at all the stuff with mutual funds and so on and so forth. That didn't come out by the regulators. A lot of that was really the New York Attorney General, but it's somebody else.
Well, he's
it's
a
some
regulator.
Guy, it's some guy inside making a phone call, equity funding. You look at all these things. The regulators simply make life tougher, add costs, and they very seldom catch the big crooks.
I think
Sarbanes-Oxley is about paper compliance trails. What you need is effective boards. That's not a matter of Sarbanes-Oxley.
It's like sitting around the table at Thanksgiving, isn't it, guys? I gotta go.
Most of the people on the boards are just there for window dressing. Great resumes, not qualified. So there's no effective oversight.
Great to see you. Sammy Antar, thank you for the time tonight. And our panel members as well. Ben Stein, thanks for the time. John Rutledge, good to see you again. John Augustine, thank you for joining us tonight from Cincinnati, and Gary Schilling, as always, nice to see you. When we come back, the contenders from the 08 presidential